You are listening to Daily Bread Devotions with Father Eustace Siame, a Salesian of Don Bosco. Your word, Lord, is a lamp for my steps. Stay tuned.
This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
It is Saturday, the 21st of August, 2021, 20th week in ordinary time. And today we remember Saint Pius X, Pope. He was born as Giuseppe Sarto near Venice, here in Italy, in 1835. He excelled in all the duties entrusted to him, and after being Bishop of Mantua for a while, he was chosen for the Patriarchal See of Venice. He always lived in great simplicity, poverty, and fortitude. In 1903, he was elected Pope and chose the name of Pius X. He soon encouraged the frequent reception of Holy Communion, initiated the codification of the Code of Canon Law, and fought against some theological errors that were sweeping through the church at that time. He died in 1914, at the beginning of World War I. Let us pray. O God, who to safeguard the Catholic faith and to restore all things in Christ, filled Pope Saint Pius X with heavenly wisdom and apostolic fortitude, graciously grant that through his teaching and example, we may gain an eternal prize. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Amen. Our first reading will be taken by Mutinta Mainza Mulenga, celebrating her birthday today, a Daily Bread member from Mazabuka, Zambia.
The first reading. The Lord has not left you this day without next of kin. This is the father of Jesse, the father of David. A reading from the book of Ruth. Ruth chapter 2 verses 1 to 3 and 8 to 11. And chapter 4 verses 13 to 17. Now, Naomi had a kinsman of her husband's, a man of wealth, of the family of Elimelech, whose name was Boaz. And Ruth the Moabitess said to Naomi, let me go to the field and glean among the ears of grain, after him in whose sight I shall find favor. And she said to her, go, my daughter. So she set forth and went and gleaned in the field after the reapers. And she happened to come to the part of the field belonging to Boaz, who was of the family of Elimelech. Then Boaz said to Ruth, now listen, my daughter. Do not go to glean in another field or leave this one, but keep close to my maidens. Let your eyes be upon the field which they are reaping, and go after them. Have I not charged the young men not to molest you? And when you are thirsty, go to the vessels and drink what the young men have drawn. Then she fell on her face, bowing to the ground, and said to him, why have I found favor in your eyes, that you should take notice of me when I am a foreigner? But Boaz answered her, all that you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband has been fully told me, and how you left your father and mother and your native land and came to the people that you did not know before. So Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife. And he went into her, and the Lord gave her conception, and she bore a son. Then the women said to Naomi, blessed be the Lord, who has not left you this day without next of kin, and may his name be renowned in Israel. He shall be to you a restorer of life and nourisher of your old age. For your daughter-in-law, who loves you, who is more to you than seven sons, has borne him. Then Naomi took the child and laid him in her bosom and became his nurse. And the women of the neighborhood gave him a name, saying, "A son has been born to Naomi." They named him Obed. He was the father of Jesse, the father of David. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our gospel passage will be taken by Father Moses Wanjala, who celebrated his priestly anniversary yesterday, a Daily Bread member and a Salesian of Don Bosco, working as a professor of theology in Jerusalem, Israel.
They preach but do not practice. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Matthew chapter 23, verses 1 to 12. At that time, Jesus said to the crowds and to his disciples, "The scribes and the Pharisees sit on Moses' seat. So practice and observe whatever they tell you, but not what they do. For they preach, but do not practice. They bind heavy burdens, hard to bear, and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move them with their finger. They do all their deeds to be seen by men, but they make their phylacteries broad and their fringes long. And they love the place of honor at feasts and the best seats in the synagogues and salutations in the marketplaces, and being called Rabbi by men. But you are not to be called Rabbi, for you have one teacher, and you are all brethren. And call no man your father on earth, for you have one Father who is in heaven. Neither be called masters, for you have one Master, the Christ. He who is greatest among you shall be your servant. Whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Today we conclude the book of Ruth. And as I was introducing it yesterday, I explained the purpose of this book. That it was a post-exilic book written after exile. And you know what happened after exile? There were intermarriages. The Israelites had learned to collaborate with other tribes and even to become families with other tribes. And Ruth was such an example. Ruth came into the Jewish family and Ruth remained in that family to the end. But the story we see unfolding is how God was opening up salvation even at that time for the rest of the world. That it was not only a privilege of the Jews. Everyone was welcome. Everyone was part of the salvific plan of God. And he makes a pagan enter into the economy of our salvation. The economic history of humanity. We see Ruth following Naomi, and we learn strategies from Ruth on how a woman is able to get a husband. Ruth does not just sit in one place and wait for the husband to come. No, Ruth goes out there, exposes herself. She tells Naomi, "Let me go and glean. Let me go to the field and glean among the ears of grain after him in whose sight I shall find favor. Let me go and expose myself." You know what gleaning was all about? It was for the poor people who, after the rich had harvested, would go and take the leftovers of the grain for their own upkeep. And she targeted the field of Boaz that she may be noticed. That Boaz may set an eye on her. She was strategic. She knew what she was looking for. And so she had to go out there to do something in order to be noticed. Don't just sit there and say, I'm not getting a husband. I have been praying. I'm doing this and that. And I am praying very hard. Expose yourself. Go and do something that will make someone to notice you. Even just going to sweep at the church. Just deciding to do some sweeping at the church, cleaning at the church, even when it is not your turn, you are becoming a Ruth who may end up having Boaz, who may end up getting a marriage that will endure. Do some charitable work. Do something that would make a man say, this is the woman I would like to marry, who is sacrificing, who humbles herself in order to get what she wants. Expose yourself. Go in the light. Don't just remain locked up in the room and pray, thinking that the husband will notice you from there. Yes, it is God who grants us the spouses. Yes, we need to pray. Pray. When you finish praying, get out from there and go and do some work at the church and go and do some charitable work somewhere. Be noticed. Ruth wants us to get that lesson clear. And what do we see about Ruth? The other thing that we learn about Ruth is that this woman, upon finding a man of her life, did not just take anything for granted. No, she had to find out what interested this man. She had to find out why this man got attracted to her. These are the things that we need to clarify at the very beginning of a relationship. When somebody gets interested in you, please make sure you have his intentions clarified. Look at Ruth. She asked Boaz, what is it that has made you really look for me? That is the simple way I can put it. But she did it much better than that. She asked, why have I found favor in your eyes that you should take notice of me since I'm a foreigner? You know, I have nothing in common with you. I'm a foreigner. But why have you developed interest in me? I don't know if you clarify these things at the beginning of a relationship, when you are getting into a relationship, when you find somebody whom you call your man, let him tell you, let her tell you what he has found in you, what she has found in you. And those things, put them down. And those things remind him even later, remind her even later, when the love starts fading, when the attraction starts fading. Remember what attracted you to me at the beginning? Please keep it. Please go back to it. And it will renew and strengthen your relationship. You are going to find yourselves renewing your relationship every time. And it will be like it's just beginning. The answer of Boaz tells us something about Ruth. Something that we need to learn from Ruth. Boaz said, you know what? My relative, Naomi, has told me what you did to her and how you remained loving to the end, even after the death of your husband. Relationship with the in-law is very important. Many of us get into marriage, and after getting into marriage, we become enemies with our mothers-in-law. And worse enough, when our husbands die, we even become worse enemies than before. But look at Ruth. If we want more blessings in our lives, if we want to get better things in our lives, please, we should keep a relationship with our in-laws. Even after your spouse has gone, keep that close tie with your in-law. You don't know what blessings will come out of that. Ruth remained loving to Naomi, the mother-in-law, even after the death of her husband. You look at yourselves right now. Many of you who are widowed, If you have not been in touch with your in-laws, and some of you even have children, look at Naomi and Ruth. There was no relationship keeping them together here because the son had not even left a child. But Ruth remained true to the end, even after the death of the husband, who never gave even a child. There was nothing linking them here. But some of you even have children, and you have taught your children not to have anything to do with your in-laws. You are bringing curses upon your own children. Please restore that relationship. It is today you need to make a call, pick up that phone and make a call to that in-law, to that father-in-law, to that mother-in-law of yours to re-establish a relationship. It's very important and it is very Christian. The gospel passage of today is in the context of the last discourses of Jesus in Jerusalem. He is towards the end of his ministry. And he is now cautioning his disciples, especially that they should take care to avoid the yeast, to avoid the exaggerations of the Pharisees and scribes. But before anything, he wants these people to be respected. They take the chair of Moses. If they take the chair of Moses, they occupy the chair of Moses despite their defects, despite the fact that they are not up to the mark. They should be listened to. They should be respected. And this goes with also the way we relate to the men and women of God, those who have dedicated their lives to God, how we have to respect them, that they have at least sacrificed themselves. They have at least done what the world has failed to do and dedicated their lives to God. For this, we should respect them. They have their own defects. They have their own mistakes. But we are going to respect them because they occupy the chair of Moses. Jesus is teaching respect here for the men and women who have dedicated their lives to God. And we have to show that respect no matter what. We have to learn to respect and treat with dignity those who have dedicated their lives to God. He says, do not be led by their lives, but by their words. They preach, yes. But they may not be living their lives as it is expected. Let that not be an excuse for you not to live a good life. Oh, you know that pastor is a drunkard. That's why I don't even go to that church. That's why I don't even listen to him. You are giving a lame excuse. That is not what is expected of you as a child of God. As a child of God, you are meant to live by the word that he's preached to you. And if you live by that word, you make sure that your life is such that whoever sees you, sees the gospel. Whoever sees you, sees the Bible. I'm telling you, even that preacher will be transformed by your own life because you become a living gospel. Then we hear those words that are often quoted by people who say, no, you people, why do you call your priest father when the Bible says you shall not call anyone father? And some are so fanatic that when they come across a Catholic priest, they will even say, Mister, excuse me, that is where we go wrong. That is where we misunderstand scripture. Jesus is not saying you are not going to call anyone father literally. No, he's saying, listen, let God be the center of our lives. He is the father. He is the pastor of our lives. He is the only teacher. He is the only shepherd. He is the only everything. All the others who are called pastors or teachers or mothers or fathers are called so by virtue of the one who is supreme. They are all subject to the Godhead, to the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, who is one God, who is the ultimate reference in our lives. And what Jesus is teaching here is humility. He's teaching humility, nothing more. He's not telling us now we stop calling our pastor, pastor, because there is only one pastor, Jesus Christ. He's not telling us now we stop calling our reverend, reverend, because there's only one reverend, one to be revered, God himself. No, he's saying, as he concludes at the end, the greatest among you shall be your servant. Whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted. That is exactly what he wants to teach us. He wants to teach us humility, humbling ourselves, because before God, all of us are small. Even the Pope is small before God. He kneels, he bends his knees in prayer, because there is only one to be acknowledged as the greatest of all, God above. And that's the one we must honor. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Blessed Saturday to you.
Thanks be to God.
This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me, and I your bed.